Good evening and welcome everyone. I'm Laura Colbank, Vice President of the Clinton PTA. Thank you all very much for being here. Preventing the senseless loss of loved ones' lives is obviously crucial to all of us. The PTA is excited to host this important community event and follow up to the Sandy Hook Promise Assemblies, which were held at Morgan and Elliott last November. Tonight you will hear about Clinton's safety initiatives, how we can each know the signs and say something to help save lives, and how Clinton is partnering with Sandy Hook Promise. At the heart of the PTA is families and community, keeping our children, teachers, staff, and everyone in our community safe and healthy is paramount to us. Sandy Hook Promise has been on our program list for over 2 years. After the Parkland shooting last February, concerns about school safety and mental health issues heightened nationwide. The PTA is proud to initiate Clinton's partnership with Sandy Hook Promise, realizing how very important it is to our entire Clinton community. Every time I read the headlines, the killers posted warning signs online, most recently in New Zealand, it's yet another reminder that these senseless shootings need to stop and confirms the importance of Sandy Hook Promise's Know the Signs programs. It's an honor to welcome Sandy Hook Promise and guest speakers Nicole Hockley and Marykay, Wishneski here tonight. I can see you slipping in there. Nicole co-founded the national nonprofit Sandy Hook Promise after she tragically lost her six-year-old son, Dylan, in the Newtown shooting in 2012. Marykay is the Sandy Hook Promise National School Outreach Coordinator and friend of Nicole. I had the pleasure of meeting Nicole and hearing her speak last fall, which was truly inspiring. I think I can speak for everyone here that we are so grateful for her courage, strength, and dedication to prevent gun violence before it happens. Nicole, what a phenomenal accomplishment that you and your team have trained over 5 million students and adults across the country, have established so many prevention programs, and done so much advocacy in such a short time. Marykay, thank you for making tonight's program possible in the assemblies at the schools. And thank you both for giving us your time tonight. The PTA extends a huge thank you to Superintendent Maryann O’Donnell, Chief of Police Vincent DeMaio, and Clinton Director of Human Services David Melillo for their collaboration on this initiative. We know you've been working hard and often behind the scenes to keep our community and schools safe. Thank you Morgan and Elliott Principals Carrie Hagness and Linda Tucker for hosting the Sandy Hook Assemblies November 29th. The Morgan Assembly was featured on NPR and included comments from our students. Senior Dan Racka shared his personal struggle regarding an incident. A few years ago, he had recognized something wasn't right, but said, "I didn't want it to get back to the kid that I'd reported him. I didn't want other people to know because it was kind of a joke, and I didn't know if that was cause enough to tell anyone." Eventually, he told his mom, who told the school. Fortunately, it wasn't an issue, but it could have been. At the assemblies, students learned how to recognize flags and how and when to say something without being a snitch. Marykay will share more. Thank you, David Melillo and Clinton Youth and Family Services for establishing the Sandy Hook Promise Save Students Against Violence Everywhere Club at Morgan. So tonight's program will start with Nicole Hockley and Marykay, who will educate us, share their mission and educate us about their Know the Signs programs. They will be followed by Superintendent O’Donnell and Chief DeMaio, who will provide some background and context about Clinton School and community safety. They will be followed by a panel discussion regarding more Clinton initiatives and programming. At this time, if you have any questions, please write them down on the cards that we provided. If you need one, please raise your hand, and then raise your hand for them and we'll collect them. Questions will be addressed as time allows. Finally, a reminder to please silence your mobile phones. And at this point, I welcome Nicole Hockley and Marykay Wishneski.
Thank you very much, and thank you for to everyone who helped organize tonight. I really appreciate the opportunity to come and speak with all of you. This is a great community. I've heard so much about it, and I have been in it before as well, and it's just an honor to be here with all of you today. My name is Nicole Hockley, and I'm one of the co-founders and managing directors at Sandy Hook Promise, and my friend Marykay is here as well, and we are here to give you a little bit more information about Sandy Hook Promise, specifically what we do, who we are and what we do, and how we do it, and the impact we're having nationally. And then Marykay is going to bring it right down home and say, what are we doing here in Connecticut, and what are we doing here in Clinton, and what are the future opportunities as well? So I'd like to start off by just saying, you know, who is Sandy Hook Promise? Because sometimes, even in Connecticut, people don't always understand who we are. And I like to start off a lot of my presentations by saying we do not represent Newtown, and we do not represent the 26 families of loss from Sandy Hook School. I represent my family, and I represent Sandy Hook Promise. And we were founded and are led by several of the families who lost someone at Sandy Hook School a little over 6 years ago. Every path through grief is unique and should be respected. And this is what myself and Mark Barden, my business partner and now, you know, my close friend and brother, decided was the way that we wanted to do to honor the loss of our children. And what mother or parent doesn't like to talk about their child? So I am a mom to two boys, Jake and Dylan. Jake is currently 14 and in ninth grade, and I was almost late today because we're having some typical 14-year-old things going on. So that's good fun. He was in third grade the day of the Sandy Hook shooting and was around towards the back of the building where his classroom was. And my youngest son, Dylan, was in his first grade classroom and was shot there along with 20 of his classmates, and he died in the arms of his special education assistant, Anne Marie Murphy, who also died while trying to protect him. And I would say that first weekend, you know, you have no clue how big things are. You're only really thinking about your family, your loss and the shock, of course. And as I also said, every path through grief is unique. I am that sort of person. It's just in my DNA that I have to do something. I couldn't shut down. I have a surviving son. And also I wanted to honor and create a legacy for my son who did not survive. And very simply, didn't want any other family to experience what I was experiencing and have been every day since then. And that's what helped me galvanize myself, I guess, and mobilize to help launch Sandy Hook Promise 1 month after the shooting. And I will be the first to say when we started out, we had no clue what we were doing. I'm very honest and open about that. We made a lot of mistakes in the early days, but that's part of growth and learning. But it took us a while to figure out, what's our voice in this movement? What exactly do we want to do? And how are we going to prevent other families from experiencing this? And how are we going to do this in a way that's meaningful and sustainable, rather than just be, you know, the shooting of the month for a few months and then disappear? That's not what I wanted to be for my children and potentially for my future grandchildren someday. So we went on a long journey to educate ourselves. And I'm gonna touch on that briefly because I think it's an interesting story in terms of how did we come up with these programs and this path in the first place. But the what we do, the why we do it is obvious. We don't want other people to experience this. The what we do is that we work on preventing violence and victimization, and within that gun violence, before it happens, by teaching people how to recognize the signs of someone who's at risk of hurting themselves or someone else, and then taking action and getting an intervention made. We also do have a C4 arm, which focuses on the human side of mental health and gun safety policy. It's not what I'm here to talk to you about tonight, because that's not what we do within the schools. The how we do this is through every platform available. We spent a lot of time studying schools and talking to schools to say, what are the barriers to getting educated on these signs and signals? So we deliver on multi-platforms, all 50 states. I'm going to go through that in more detail later. And then we work to sustain them through student clubs, which is an organic learning that we had with working with schools around the country. And it was the youth who said, let us lead this. And then since Parkland, obviously, we've seen that massively accelerated. And we have always focused on two generations, because when you think about behavioral change, when you think about social change, you can't just talk to adults. You need to talk to kids, because they're the ones that are going to make the change happen. When you think about designated driver, that was something that I grew up with, a program that taught us how to behave if there's alcohol in driving, and saved hundreds of thousands of lives without policy. If you think about recycling, it's the kids who taught us parents what we needed to do. And this is the same kind of thing. You need to tackle it on two generations, which is why we work in schools. Right after we made some initial choices right after the shooting as to what we wanted to do, we had a big failure in April 2013 on a policy front. And you know, I come from a business background, and as do my fellow co-founders, and we said, okay, we did something wrong here. If the low-hanging fruit can't even be achieved, then we need to tackle this a different way. And we need to study this much more. So we spent about a year talking to academic experts, talking to mental health experts, talking to gun safety experts, talking to social change and movement experts, talking a lot to educators and superintendents and teachers, and said, what's going on? And from law enforcement and the studies that we did of other shooting tragedies and suicides, we learned more about leakage and signs and signals, and that the fact that more often than not, before an act of violence or self-harm is committed, people display these at-risk behaviors. It was the same with the Sandy Hook shooter, which makes us know that it was a preventable act of violence and knows that we can then teach other people how to recognize these signs and signals and prevent violence. We also spent a lot of time pulling together all of these learnings to really inform our strategy. And one thing, there's four key things we learned. The first thing was that schools are safe. Schools are one of the safest places to be in your community, but they are not immune to violence. They are not immune to suicide. They are not immune to bullying, cutting, sexual abuse, substance abuse, relationship abuse. There's a lot of behaviors here, and especially when we think about middle and high schools, age 13 to 17, when a lot of these at-risk behaviors start to manifest, there's a lot of education and awareness that we can bring to our kids so that they can look out for each other, but also to the adults so that they know what to look for and then how to help that child appropriately. The second key thing that we learned was that gun violence and victimization is really caused by a lack of mental wellness, not mental illness. There's a lot of stigma and attached, and there certainly was after Sandy Hook, to, oh, this person must be mentally ill. Someone with a diagnosable mental illness is far more likely to be a victim rather than a perpetrator. It's really this lack of mental wellness that we're talking about. Conflict resolution skills, anger management skills, the feel of that the world's against me and I need to retaliate, bullying and chronic social isolation. These are things that a typical person might not have any problems managing, but someone who's on this pathway behavior towards violence and has access to means to carry out something, that's when you've got a recipe for tragedy. So we really decided to focus a lot on mental wellness. We also learned, as I said before, that there are almost always signs. 4 out of 5 school shooters have told at least one other person of what they intend to do, with about 70% of those telling more than one person. In the case of people who ideate on suicide or complete death by suicide, they're usually, about 70% of them are giving off signs and signals. But we're not taught how to recognize them and then what to do with them. And it's the kids that are really the most important because so much of this is on social media. And as you all, the parents in the room know, or I hope you know, the kids are not on the same platforms that you are, plain and simple. We're on Facebook. My 14-year-old would never, ever go on Facebook. He educated me on fake Instagram. I had no idea that even existed. They're talking about things, and if they're seeing these things all the time, and if they don't understand what they're seeing and don't have the tools to do something about it, that's when we have disasters. And that's why we hear, oh, I thought something was gonna happen. Oh, I heard him say something the other day. Yeah, I saw the cuts on her arm, but I didn't know what was going on. And also, a lot of times kids will say, well, if they put it out on social media, they weren't serious, or someone else will take care of it. And we have to really educate our kids that no, if someone's putting it out there, does that mean they're going to commit an act of violence? Not necessarily, but it means something's going on in their life that means they need help. And that's where we can stand up and create an intervention. The final thing we learned before I talk about the programs is that there are no national programs teaching people how to recognize the signs. There's a lot of regional attempts. It's very fragmented. And even in one district, you can have one school talking about a suicide prevention line, for example, and another school promoting a different practice with different phone numbers on the websites. Strength comes from consistency of voice and education. Strength comes from an entire district or state speaking with one voice, educating children with one voice and what to do, and taking actions together. We also know that, unfortunately, programs like the ones we do when we talk to educators, there's so many barriers to implementation. It's time out of the classroom. It costs money. It takes away from study time. It's one more thing for a teacher to do in their already overflowing plate. And also, there's not often a lot of measurement. A lot of fantastic programs out there, but not as many of them are evidence-based, truly showing a measurable impact of their effectiveness. And finally, a lot of these programs are one and done. Too many educators said, yep, we love programs, but you're in, you train for a week, and we don't hear from you until the following year when you want to come train again. That's not how you create change. That's not how you sustain behavior. And when you're talking about recognizing signs and signals, when you're talking about reaching out and saying hello to someone and including them, these aren't things that you can just practice for a week and be done. It needs to be part of every day. It needs to be front of mind until it becomes a habit, like designated driver. It becomes so front of mind that you would never think about drinking and getting in a car and driving it. So that's where we decided we're going to be that organization, because there's no one else doing it. We're going to be that organization to educate people on how to know the signs. We're going to deliver it at no cost to schools, because we very firmly believe that money should never be a barrier to saving a life. We're going to deliver it on every platform that we can think of, whether it's in person, digital downloads, interactive videos, train the trainers, whatever works for a school or community. And we're going to then sustain everything through student clubs. Before I go quickly just to talk about what the programs are, because Marykay is going to go into a little bit more depth, there is a video to show, which I'm a marketing person by background. We launched this in December 2016, and I had the lofty objective of maybe getting 1 million views on it. Some of you may have seen this before, and we'll briefly talk about it afterwards before we go on to it's a really slow screen. But I think it, when you do see the video, it's a way that brings to life why it's so important to know the signs in a way that me talking endlessly cannot do quite as effectively. Thank you.
some news today from the radio man. He spoke the words somber and as softly as he can. The world stood still and the sky opened up. I made my way to fill up my coffee cup. Then it occurred to me as the daylight sky shone blue, today's the day that Johnny met June. He waited a while, he knew that it would. He was gonna hang around here for as long as he could. The days went by and I was at a past. He was never sure just how long he would last. But there's not much love in a lonely room. Today's the day that Johnny met June.
Good summer.
You too.
Thanks.
Hey, you must be bored.
No way.
This is the guy that I was running through the library.
Okay.
Yeah,
I don't know. Guilty. So you like to write on desks?
Yeah, that's what I do.
Said at the beginning of that, you know, we'd set a lofty goal of having a million people view it, and we thought that would be exceptional. In about a month, we had 155 million views, and this really just spread like crazy. I had teachers calling me and saying, you know, I just got into class, and the kids are gathered around the science lab desk all watching this video, or newscasters saying, my child brought this home to me, can you talk to me about this? And I think the reason it was so successful is not only because it's a well-done commercial, but it's a compelling idea, and it's a way that no one has ever talked about gun violence prevention before, with saying that there is something going on that we need to keep our eyes open for and recognize people who need help. And it's not just one sign. You know, someone who is watching, reading a gun magazine, that does not mean that they are a shooter or that they're at that harm. But if you're seeing ideation, if you're seeing bullying, if you're seeing a lack of being able to control emotions, if you're seeing a lot of the other signs that were presented there, plus tons more that's available in the brochures that we have where people can learn what are the kind of buckets to look for, it's this accumulation of signs that means someone needs help. Again, it's not an indicator of violence per se, but it's someone who needs help, needs an intervention, because they might be on a pathway to making some poor choices, which could ultimately result in loss of life or self-harm. So the programs that we do, we have our Know the Signs programs that are four, which Marykay will talk about for Connecticut and Clinton. We have Start with Hello, which is really at the far end of the spectrum in terms of violence prevention. And it's helping kids understand what does chronic social isolation look like? And how do we teach connection and inclusivity? How can we teach our kids those tools about just going up to someone they don't yet know, saying hello and helping them, starting a conversation? They could make a great friend, but they also don't know where that kid's come from, what they've just experienced, what's going on in their mind. Have they been pushed out or have they withdrawn? And sometimes that simple act of saying hello or making contact, eye contact with someone, validating them and saying, I see you, that can massively change the trajectory of someone's life. So simple acts that make a huge difference. We also have a program on signs of suicide. There's a screener element of that. It's the only peer-reviewed program in the country right now that is proven to reduce suicidal ideation and attempts. And it teaches adults and kids how you recognize the signs of someone who could be chronically depressed or potentially ideating and reach out to get them help. Our other program, Safety Assessment and Intervention, is where we teach school teams how do you deal with all these threats. If you hear something from a teacher on one side of the campus or one side of the building, how do you tie that together and connect it to a teacher who's seeing the same at-risk behavior in the other side of the building? And how do you dig deep? Because more often than not, it's not about the threat itself. It's about everything else that's going on in that child's life that can really help illuminate the situation and therefore the pathway to help. And finally, our Say Something with the anonymous reporting system, where we teach kids how do you recognize at-risk behaviors in your peers, particularly on social media, and then take action by either telling a trusted adult, or if your school or district has the anonymous reporting system, by anonymously reporting this tip so that then law enforcement can get involved if it's a life safety issue, or the school crisis team can get involved if it's a non-life safety issue. These programs that we do, you know, my nexus is gun violence, plain and simple, but that's not what our programs are all about. The programs might be targeted at the 6 to 8% of kids who might go on to commit an act of violence or self-harm, but because of the way that we teach them and because of the anonymous reporting system as well, we're helping the 92 to 94% who might never become violent but might suffer from other at-risk issues, substance abuse, opioid addiction, bullying, cutting, abuses in all sorts of forms, because all of these are at-risk behaviors that we can help and intervene for our kids. Our impact to date, we've actually got new numbers since was last said in our last audit. We've now trained 6.5 million youth and adults from all 50 states. We're active in about 14,000 schools right now. The state of Pennsylvania recently took us on in January with the anonymous reporting system. We launched that in March. I've had about 14,000 tips to date, and at the moment I've lost track on how many school shooting threats have been averted as a direct result of that. Suicide attempts, direct interventions, sexual abuse, substance abuse, and of course bullying and cutting as well. We are making a difference, but we need all of your help. Because we need parents to help advocate for this for their children. We need schools to take this on. And it's free. So there's really no barrier. We do all the work so that the schools don't have to. If anyone here, before I hand over to Marykay, if anyone here is interested in learning more or being involved, obviously there's questions and answers during the panel. My simple request of you is just get engaged. This isn't something that you can just say it's never going to happen to me, because we're not just talking about school shootings, we're talking about at-risk behaviors. So if there is a child in your life, if there is a teenager in your life, you have to engage in this, because kids are always suffering from something that we need to be able to help them with. So go to the website, sandyhookpromise.org, make the promise. You'll start getting a lot of emails from me. I apologize in advance. You can become a promise leader, which are like our super advocates around the country. You can volunteer virtually, you can donate so we can continue to save more lives. You can simply share our message. If you've learned anything new today, just talk about it. Let other people know that there are other tangible solutions to preventing gun violence today that aren't polarizing and confrontational, because that's not for everybody. And I appreciate that. And obviously help bring our programs to your schools. But Marykay is going to talk right now about what's already going on here, and then we'll move to the panel afterwards. So thank you very much.
So if you're like me, the first time I saw that Evan video, I actually had to replay it about four times because I missed signs and I couldn't believe all that was going on in the background. So if you'd like to watch it again, it is up on our YouTube channel. If you go to YouTube, Sandy Hook Promise has an approved channel where we have a lot of videos that are helpful to watch. So everybody's been saying my name a lot. It's Marykay Wishneski, and I'm so glad to be here. I was in Clinton over the summer and had a great meeting with, you know, the superintendent, everybody, when we first started talking about our programs. And it's been amazing to see the program start to launch here, which is exciting. I do, you know, when you talk about these numbers nationwide and you think, when you look on a map, how small Connecticut can look, but really right here already in our state, our programs have already trained over 150,000 students in one or more of our programs. That's in about 120 different towns here in Connecticut. So our programs are growing here, which is just wonderful to be a part of. My family and I live in Sandy Hook, Connecticut. We've been there for about 16 years now. And I really feel lucky to work at Sandy Hook Promise, where I can say I'm doing something to make a difference every day. I've been there about 2.5 years in this capacity as a school outreach coordinator, and one of my big focuses is Connecticut, so I'm really glad to be here. So I talked a little bit about Connecticut, and then here in Clinton about 2 years ago, two of your schools did our Start With Hello program, which, as Nicole mentioned, is almost an entry-level program. It is for every school in the district, whether it's elementary, middle, or high school, and does talk to the students about what social isolation is and why it's not good for a community. And when we talk about communities, we're not only talking about their school community, but anywhere that they're social. So they could have a sports community or a neighborhood community or a religious community. And just to how to kind of recognize when someone is feeling isolated. And then we give the students a toolbox of ways to reach out and connect. And that could be a simple hello, it could be eye contact. If you're a guy, you can do this. And you've like had a whole conversation, that's a great gesture to share. So a lot of different ways to reach out and connect through that Start With Hello program. The other student-facing program we have is Say Something. So those are the programs where the students are trained directly. And Say Something just launched here in early November. And very exciting for us to come and train both the middle school and the high school. We had one of our Promise presenters come, and it was a great training. And we've heard some great feedback from the superintendent and the chief of police as well based on those trainings. So Say Something again is our program that is a little more serious. It's only intended for those middle school and high school audiences, where it is training the students, what are the warning signs, what are the warning signals, where can they be found. Social media, as Nicole said, is a big part of that. And then what do the students do when they find this information? Who do they talk to? What are the steps there? So we know, you know, that this program has stopped many things across our nation. And then the other two programs Nicole mentioned, they are the programs where we train adults in the communities, whether that's on signs of suicide or the threat assessment and intervention program. So we have these great four Know the Signs programs that we're using across our nation. And one of the questions that we get asked a lot is, you know, after you come to a program, how does the school keep that sustained? So one of the things that I wanted to talk a little bit more is our Save Promise Clubs. Now, SAVE stands for Students Against Violence Everywhere, and it's not a new organization. They're actually celebrating their 30th anniversary this year. They're a group that started in North Carolina. It was by a group of students. They were at a party and they watched a friend get shot. And they formed the first SAVE club, and they got other high schools in their area forming their own SAVE clubs. And they did such a great job that the state of North Carolina adopted SAVE as a statewide program. And from there they grew nationally. So when we connected with the SAVE folks a couple years ago, I hope you all could have heard me before. When we connected with the SAVE folks a couple of years ago, to me, I feel like it's our secret sauce. You know, we have these great programs, and now we're empowering the students to come up with creative ideas and activities to share and implement throughout the school year and beyond. You know, ideas to keep the program trainings kind of in the forefront of everybody's mind and keep the program sustained. And I'll just share a couple of examples of what Safe Promise Clubs have done. There is a middle school in Connecticut who their Safe Promise Club is their student government club. And a group of these students realize that, you know, they recognize sometimes on a student's birthday, their friends come to school early and decorate their locker. But they recognized that not every student was getting their locker decorated. So they went to the guidance office and they asked if every month they could get a list of birthdays. And that club now decorates every student's locker for their birthday. So that's just one example. And what I love about these examples is that these are ideas that came directly from the students. It wasn't an adult's idea, you know, telling the students to go do this. There's another club that the first Friday of every month, they are outside greeting every student as they get off the bus, whether it's hello in different languages or sidewalk chalk messages or secret handshakes, but they are making sure that everybody is said hello to once a month. So just some ideas of what our Safe Promise Clubs are doing. We have many Safe Promise Clubs in Connecticut, and I'm so glad to say that the Morgan Schools Club is part of that as well. Another way that we help sustain these programs is by doing a call to action week for each of those two programs, Start with Hello and Say Something, every year. So this is a week we pick on the calendar. It's September for Start with Hello as the kids are coming back to school, and February for Say Something. And our call to action weeks are put out there nationwide. We get thousands of schools signing up to participate. We offer a lot of resources during this week. The students are taking videos and taking pictures and planning their weeks. This is a great way that the SAVE clubs are involved with planning how the week is going to go. And following the week, they have an opportunity to apply for a couple different awards. We have some contests. One of those contests is even a student voices contest for Start with Hello, where students are submitting artwork or poetry or a video. So it's a chance for us to hear and learn from the students. So to start to wrapping up, you know, I talked about our growth in Connecticut and what Clinton's been doing. And, you know, my hope for Clinton is to continue using these programs and sustaining them through the Safe Promise Clubs. I think that there's, you know, the Safe Promise Club here is relatively new, so we're looking forward to really seeing a lot of great stuff come out of that. And then I just wanted to mention actually something, another question that we get asked a lot is, you know, how do you know your programs work? And as I said, we do get a lot of feedback from schools, and it's always great to hear. But I'm just going to tell you about something that happened right here in Connecticut 2 days ago. So I've been working with Seymour Public Schools down in Seymour, Connecticut, and with their director of security there, who I only met a week before Say Something Week. And he contacted us about our programs, and he was interested. And I said, you know, I know the timing's tight, but we've got this call to action week coming up for Say Something where we could come in person and train your students. And he said, I'm going to make it happen. So during that call to action week, which was the last week of February, we were able to go to both their middle school and their high school with one of our in-person promise presenters and train those students and Say Something. And he's looping back now about the anonymous reporting system and wants to do more programming. They've got their clubs, you know, set up and ready to go. So he called me yesterday and he said, I'm calling to let you know that your Say Something program legitimately stopped a school shooting here. He said, our students started noticing some warning signs on Friday afternoon and throughout the weekend, and they came to school on Monday morning. And this handful of students went right to their guidance counselor and started sharing everything. And he said by Monday afternoon, we had a warrant, and with the state attorney office and our local police, we went to this house, immediately took the student into custody and searched the home. And he said, what we found was very disturbing. There were plans, there were lists, there were, you know, how the weapon was gonna be attained and everything like that. What these students noticed is this one student in particular had started to ask questions about the school security officer and what his schedule was and where he was at 11 o'clock during the day. And then they started to put these pieces together and they said something. And during this call, the director of security there is ex-military. He's a really big guy. He got emotional on the phone and he said, if it weren't for your program, you know, adults never would have seen these signs. Adults never would have heard this stuff. And we would have been looking at a much different situation here. He said, the kids came to me after they went to their guidance counselor and they thanked me for having the program here. And he said, they came and they said, oh, we know we have to say something. And he said, oh yeah, you should always say something. And the kid said, no, say something like the assembly you had, and that's how we knew what to do. So, like, I've held that story so close in my heart for the last 2 days because it's right here in Connecticut. And kind of the explanation point is there, is that this was a middle school student. You know, we often talk about there's no entry age to violence, and, you know, we can train students grades 6 through 12 to look for these warning signs, and it just really goes to show that this training works, you know, these programs work. So I'm really excited about the growth here in Clinton. I'm glad to be back here. Even your neighboring towns here are really getting involved with our programming too, so it's exciting to be in this part of our state. And with that, I'm actually gonna be turning it over to Superintendent and Chief of Police, and thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. We're excited to be here. While we're just kind of introducing the next part of the program, I'd like to invite our panelists to come on up to the stage and have a seat at the table. I think they know who they are. So one of the things that when we first began discussion both with members from Human Services in town and with the PTA about the possibility of bringing Sandy Hook Promise to Clinton, the chief and I had been doing a lot of work together starting when we both came into the roles 3 years ago to really look at how we connect services and really enhance the school community and the safety of the school community here in Clinton. And that has been a tremendous partnership. And when this conversation started with PTA and with Human Services about the programming that Sandy Hook Promise brings, we did meet this summer and started to have that conversation about what we currently do in Clinton. And what I think we found was that there were a lot of, oh, really? Oh, wow. And there are certain things that I think people are aware of, and then there's a lot of things that are happening in our schools and in our partnerships that maybe people aren't aware of. And that was something that PTA membership in particular said, people need to hear this. And so part of the idea of tonight's program was when we knew that Nicole and Marykay could come and could work with our students and then share with adults and community members about their programming, we wanted to dovetail that a little bit with what is happening in Clinton, where we intend to go, and the resources and the things that we provide to our students and through Human Services to the community at large. So part of the panel is going to be a little bit of sharing related to that. I think I'm going to ask the principals to share a little bit about the Sandy Hook Promise programming that's happened, and the chief and I will talk a little bit about maybe a little more of the physical safety components that we can share. But I really enjoyed listening to Nicole, and a couple things really resonated. That idea of mental wellness has been something that's been really, I think, a hallmark of Clinton in providing support services and partnerships that try to nurture the mental wellness of our students. And I'm really proud of that, and that really resonated because I think these programs that we're bringing into the district just reinforce many of the pieces we had in place, and I just see a coherence as we move forward. So I'm excited about that. I just talked a lot, and my panelists are up here. I want to turn it over to the chief just for a moment, and then we'll get into the panel questions. So I'm going to let you talk for a moment, and then we can get settled at the table.
I listened, Dre, so I'm going to pick this up and just walk around. First of all, I want to thank everyone for coming here and being part of this tonight, because it's your participation that helps make our schools safer. It really helps this process along. I want to thank Nicole and Marykay for coming out. And we're going to talk a lot about the things that we do here in Clinton to try and make the schools safer to all campuses that we have here. I think it's very important that everyone in the audience to know that the safety of these campuses is paramount to every man and woman in my police department, certainly in the administration of the school, as well as the faculty of the school. The paramount of everyone on these the safety of everyone on these campuses is paramount to all of us. And we do a lot of work to approach this situation. I think an important thing for everybody to remember is this is going to be the 20th year of Columbine. That happened in 1999. Every single student in our school systems today, in the elementary level up through high school, has lived with this. We all grew up with, you know, I'm looking at the audience and judging by the audience, I'm going to say we all grew up with fire drills, going outside, meeting the flagpole, somebody pulled the fire alarm, we went and did all that, and that was the concern. And all of our schools have been kind of built that way, which has presented a lot of problems for law enforcement and for schools as well. Listen, they're designed so we can exit quickly. You have tons of doors, you have tons of exits, so in case of a fire, everyone can get out. Well, in this country, a child hasn't died in a school fire since 1954. Okay, we've had hundreds of school shootings post-Columbine. So our kids know that this is a real threat. They understand that. And we work very hard here in Clinton to have a holistic approach to how we deal with this situation. We work very closely with the school system to talk to kids, to have plans that are specific. Now, we look at it as a holistic approach. We do a lot of things at the police department now that we didn't particularly do in the past with certain ends to make inroads and have a connection to the demographic that we need, the students particularly. So we have DARE program. It's in our middle school, and it's in our elementary school at two different levels. We have a DARE officer there, teaches the fourth grade, and we also teaches the sixth grade. Again, just so we can get that connection so kids feel good and understand that they can come talk to our police officers, and if they have a problem, they see something, we're starting to develop that relationship. In the high school, we have our SRO. It was specifically picked through a selection process with the faculty of the high school and with the school administration to really make sure that we had someone in that position that could connect with this demographic, with this group of high school kids. This is obviously a very difficult group for us to make connections with. When you're an adolescent, you're gonna push back against authority, you're gonna find your own way. So it's important that we had somebody in here that could really connect with it, with the student body and be able to talk to us. So as Marianne said, she's only gave me a couple minutes before she gives me the hook. I'm gonna sit down and we'll talk about the many things that we do to really work on school safety. There's a lot of things that we're not gonna be able to tell you. And I know that's difficult for a lot of people to hear, but the efficacy of our plans and the things that we do in these school systems can't be told to you because it really diminishes their effectiveness. If everybody knows what we're going to do, it's not very helpful. But understand that we do take it very seriously and we meet every month. And it's a very fluid, very dynamic process. So it's constantly being updated. So I will stop now.
So I do want to just share, and then we'll turn to some of the program implementation that we did this year and some of the feedback that our administrators can share with all of you about the training and some of the efforts in partnership with our human services. But one of the things that the chief and I established, we talked about for a while and got up and running this summer, was what we call the School Crisis Advisory Board. And that's a group of first responders, mental health professionals in our schools, in the community, our nurse and police officers who meet monthly. And what we do in those meetings is really evaluate all of the different facets of school safety. This year we have focused on developing some of these programs. We focused in particularly on our training regimens and our protocols and refining those routines and are continuing to evolve those because it's not a static process. And every time we do a drill or every time we are in a situation that might be real, we learn something new. And so we've created processes where following those drills, we evaluate with first responders, and then monthly we look at information. In addition, one of our major focal points this year as part of that crisis advisory board was communication, both within an incident among our staff and our students, as well as being able to communicate with first responders in those situations. And in any kind of a crisis, we need the ability to do that quickly and efficiently. And so we've spent a lot of time exploring that and talking about that and have some exciting pieces that we're going to be implementing. And again, these are part of systems that can't be broadly shared, but we're looking to enhance that so we can respond appropriately in crisis situations. And then we're developing the capacity of our school staff as well as our common approaches so that we can be proactive and preventive and also respond within a situation. And so that's a commitment that the chief made and that I made, that we would do that monthly, and it continues to evolve. And it allows us to address situations as they come up. And that, you know, one of the things that Marykay and Nicole really emphasized that resonated with me was this idea of sustainability. And we are very much, and I am very much, a systematic and systems-oriented person, because whatever we do, we have to do it systematically, and we have to be able to refine it, but sustain it. And if we're going to commit our efforts, we need to commit to the components that will allow us to do that over time. And so I think a lot of the work that we're doing is to make sure we can sustain and that we connect the pieces together within our schools and our community so that we're really effective, not just for our students, but for our entire community. And as all of you know, before I turn it over, we've faced a lot of difficulty this year. We faced loss, we faced crisis, and not just this year, but this year has been particularly difficult, I think, for many of us on a variety of levels, not just violence, but loss and trauma. And I think that has strengthened us and has made us even more aware of how important that idea of mental wellness, caring and nurturing for each other, and really recognizing when people are struggling and being able to systematically have a frame of reference of how we know and how we respond. And we're not there yet, but that has really, I think, been a big part of our conversations and has really resonated with us. So I'm gonna turn it over to our panel over here. I'm gonna let them introduce you. Hopefully they're familiar faces. But if each of you will introduce yourself, and then I'd like you to share just a little bit about some of the mental health and mental wellness programming, and maybe a little bit from our building administrators about the SAVE clubs and some reaction from the assemblies, if you would.
I'm David Melillo, and I'm the director of Clinton Human Services. I'm a relative newcomer. I've been here for about 7 or 8 months. One of the things that I wanted to say that I wasn't planning on saying is that 6, 7, 8 years ago, when I worked in Madison, I was doing a report on school violence for my board and the Board of Education. And the information that I found at that time, and you probably came across it too at some point, was that with all the things of buzzing people in and locking all the other doors and the high resistance glass and the concrete barriers, all of those things that people were putting tons of money into as physical barriers and are very important, but they couldn't really prove that they had saved a life. Now, part of it is if they worked, you don't know that they saved a life. I do understand that. But what did save lives were people talking. And there was a town, I can't think of the name of it, but it was in north central Connecticut, which we don't remember. And it was a situation where a young woman stepped forward and said, "I'm concerned, the police found a ton of weapons, a target list, a date for the attack, and everything like that." So similar to the other situation you were addressing. So we work with kids. Clinton Human Services includes the Youth and Family Services part, PIC, which is Partners in Community, our Drug and Alcohol Prevention Coalition, and the social services part of it, which is less directly connected to kids. And I was really pleased coming into the community because these folks that I'm sitting up here with really care about kids. And I have seen people going out of their way and battling with them, torturing themselves to think, what else could I do better? They're concerned not just about the kids' SAT scores and grades, they are very, very concerned about the entire child and wanting to have a happy child. And as someone who's been doing this, who came in as an outsider, I thought you should know that. You have some good folks in place. The programs that we do at Human Services, we do provide individual and family counseling. We have a peer advocate program, REACT program, which connects to PIC. We have a summer enrichment program. We have a lot of programs that are based on really working to strengthen kids and to get them involved in, some of them, in getting them involved in helping others. And so do the schools, and so do the police. So it is kind of an across-the-board kind of effort where we are trying to do those things. The thing that I would like to tell you about in a little detail is the suicide prevention program. We wrote a grant and we received it for $20,000 over 2 years to do this suicide prevention program. And really, the schools bent over backwards to accommodate this happening and this happening within this academic year, which I realize was a difficult task for them to pull off, but they did it. And as of tomorrow, every single teacher and every paraprofessional, or virtually every paraprofessional, is going to be trained in QPR. And QPR is suicide and depression related. It is also an evidence-based approved national program, and it really just takes people who are connected to kids and teaches them how to notice the signs better and what to do to get that person to help. It's a great program, and the entire school system is tomorrow going to all be trained in it. Then the students will get a component. For the younger children, it'll be Gizmo, who's a very cute little dog. And those of you with younger kids will see signs of some of the Gizmo stuff that comes home. But it helps kids to think about feeling down. It helps them to think about who they would go to when they're having a hard time. They identify that person, that connection is made between kid and person. And it's something that can begin to follow the kid and a way to check in on how that person is doing. At the middle schools and the high school, SOS, which was mentioned earlier, every kid will be receiving, well, during their health classes, kids will be receiving the SOS program. I think this effort is going to make a really significant change in terms of people knowing when to say something. You know, we've had kids come and tell us, look at this thing on Facebook, what do you think? Does it scare you as much as it scares me? And yeah, and we react, and sometimes we even need to call the police to react to do that and respond immediately. And people who were very suicidal end up going to the hospital. I think this will just spread that out so that hopefully we'll get more people and capture more people and get more people the help that they need.
Good evening, I'm Carrie Hagness, I'm principal at Morgan here. I've been here since 2007, and I can say that our students are amazing here and your children are amazing. There's a connection that we have in the school, and it is something that's based on just the fact that the level of trust and the opportunity for our kids to share, because I feel that the emphasis for me is most important on relationships. And I've told the teachers that I know that we're really focused on the hierarchy of needs in terms of Bloom's taxonomy and higher order thinking.
but I hit them hard with Maslow's needs and realizing that when students come in, they need that sense of safety, that need that sense of belonging. And when they know that we care, they will share. And not every day they come in and they're ready. We have to really kind of be very aware every day. And every morning, my assistant principal and I will sit downstairs and watch students as they come in. It's the best part of my day, because I get to see them. And I get to see them, and I know that when they walk in, if there's something that just doesn't seem quite right, that there needs to be some connection there for what's going on. And the idea that Nicole talked about really resonated with me. We look out for each other. And that's the message that we send, the idea that we're a family and that there's times when things are gonna be hard. There's gonna be times when there's stress in their lives and they're not sure what direction to take. We'll share with all of you some of that stress and pressure. The complexity of being a teenager today is so overwhelming and they're inundated with so much. And I can see it on their faces when they walk in every day. And we really want the older students to recognize the importance of mentoring. And I think some of the programs really speak to how we treat each other and the opportunity for us to look at the two programs, Start With Hello. The kids really embrace that. They enjoy the idea of looking at students and getting out of their box, getting out of their friend group and recognizing, gosh, what if that was me sitting by themselves? What if that was me? So there's just a different way. And the idea of saying something, and I can say that after the assembly that we had in November, I just actually found out from a parent who came in and we were talking about something related to their child, and she mentioned and thanked me for the assembly because her son came home that day and actually is a very high achiever here, but broke down and said that he was suffering from depression. And I thought, that's what makes this work. So thank you, I appreciate that.
I think this works. So I'm Linda Tucker, I'm the principal at Jared Elliott Middle School, and I've been there, I think next year will be my 15th year. And I started off at Morgan. We start every day and end every day at Elliott with the administrators and staff greeting students and making sure they get on their buses. And there's a reason why we've done that every single day. It's because when they get off their buses, you can tell a lot of things about some of them. We have a breakfast program at Elliott, and there are at least four students I check in with every day to make sure they've had breakfast. Because oftentimes they don't have it at home and you can't really learn anything if you're hungry. So we make sure that we have the doors open and there's someone there at about 10 after 7, just so we can, you know, be sure that kids are able to eat and that they start their day in a good place. When your students come to Elliott, the first thing that's going to be really different for them is they're going to have a guidance program. We have really outstanding guidance counselors. They meet with every single student at least four times a year at every grade and just talk about to them individually for a period of time about their goals, how they're doing, how they're progressing, any concerns that they may have. They also go out to every single class for a considerable period of time and they do a developmental program. And they talk about things like feelings, emotions, stress, anxiety, how to deal with time management, how to be better organized, how to practice things about how you do talk to people, how to deal with things when you feel badly, and how to report those kind of things. Kids can then, if they need to see their guidance counselor, they can make an appointment. They can just, there's a box outside of every door, they can just put a little note in and say, you know, I need to see you today. We work with everyone in our building, including our nurse, and being sure that she lets us know and lets the counselors or the school social worker or the psychologist know if there's an issue that we need to be aware of. And sometimes kids come to school and beyond being hungry, there are other things physically going on. So we try to be sure that they have if they need school supplies, if they need clothing, if they need anything, we try to be sure that we meet those needs for them. We have our teaming approach. When I came from the high school, I hadn't experienced that, but our teaming approach is so phenomenal because you have core teachers who just share those students. They know them. They know not only how they learn, but they also know how they are every single day. So if they, and they do, we have had professional development pick up on signs, let us know if there's any stressors going on, what can we do to try to address that? Be in contact with parents. Our school psychologists and social worker run groups, see individual students, come into our lunchrooms, be sure that no student, and we're very sure of that because an administrator is in every single lunch, at least one, it's mostly two, to be sure that no student is eating alone. There isn't any kind of, you know, clicky group thing going on, that we can try to pick up on any kind of signs that there are issues going on so we can address them as quickly as we possibly can. We have a strong after-hours program where we try to insert into the after-hours program specific kind of groups or plans or clubs or whatever activities that will address a broad range of interests for students and try to keep the vast majority of them engaged. And I'm pretty proud to say that even though in years past we've experienced budget cuts, we've been able to maintain a pretty robust after-hours program. Our student government is where we try to put under that the Say Hello program and SAVE. They've been able to push out and create certain activities and things for kids to keep them as engaged as we possibly can. We practice our drills pretty religiously. We debrief after all of them. We talk, we listen to the staff. It's from the staff that we got a lot of ideas about how just to make our building safer.
So Linda, I'm gonna ask both you and Carrie, because you've hit on a couple things. One is the SAVE clubs and the emphasis that we have and our Board of Ed has supported with our guidance counselors, our school psychologists, social workers. We have BCBAs in our building, so we really do have this cohesive staff approach. There's a couple questions that came in, though, about the reporting system, and that's something you guys mentioned tonight, the SARS anonymous reporting system, and it's been a conversation we've had since the summer. So one of the questions is about, and I'll talk about, are we planning to implement, because that's a question here, and some of the work that I've done and where we plan to go with our crisis advisory board related to that. But one of the questions, and I know some of the answer, is how do we find out? So we're present, we see them, but can you, either of you, talk about some of the ways that students, parents, kids have come to you, because we have heard things and we have intervened and we deal with this a lot, and I don't think many of you know that. So what are the avenues that kids have used to make you aware, or maybe parents too, that there are concerns, that they're seeing some signs that they're concerned about?
So all of the professionals in the building can pick up on signs and we can address those, but for kids, they form such, at least with one teacher, often almost all of them on their teams, such a strong relationship that we oftentimes get information from students who will bring a concern to a teacher they feel really comfortable with. And we, one of the things we did a couple of years ago was we did an internal audit of asking kids, is there at least one person in the building you feel comfortable with? And we were completely surprised by the result, because we had well over, almost every single kid said they could identify an adult in the building they felt comfortable with. I think there were about 14 who said, no, there really wasn't. When we questioned those, because we wanted to find out, well, is there a problem? They said it's because we feel most comfortable talking to our parents. So we emphasize that strong connection to our teachers. Tell a teacher, tell someone you're comfortable with, tell a guidance counselor, tell the school social worker, tell the psychologist, tell the nurse. If you can even tell, you know, if you want to, come to the office and or give something, that we have some kind of idea if there is an issue going on. It happens with fidelity is what I'd like to say to you. As late as last week, for instance, we had a couple of students who came forward and said they had seen something disturbing on social media. We passed that information along to the police department. It was not a student in our building or at the high school. It was a student in another school. But they were they knew this student. They were concerned about it. We told the police department. They did it. They did do an investigation. Reported back to us that they had researched it, spoken to the parents, and they had dealt with it. So we're very cognizant of and encouraging students to let us know, to let someone know, to be comfortable with that.
Carrie, how about you? Because I can think of a few unique ways that you and I have received some information too.
I'd say that with the opportunity for them to even share with us at night, and oftentimes it's at night where they see something and we're not in school and we can't go down to a guidance office, and they are really great about sharing that on their email. They'll screenshot something for me, and right away I'm able to act and call who I need to call, and we're on top of it. Our kids are amazing that way, and we've been able to really address it and be able to pre-plan how we're gonna act the morning of, and what are the degrees of who I need to involve and how I need to involve it, and whether I need to involve it right away that evening and contact the police as a result of some things that have come up. And I think that has offered them an avenue of quick reaction. And then we've had some morning meetings with students on some things that have happened because things have been posted on social media. And I have the decision as to what do I do? And sometimes we'll bring everybody together and I'll give them basically a very open, this is what's going on. And I want it to be something that you guys hear from me because I know it's out there. I know you guys are talking about it. And this is kind of what happened, how we're handling it, and here's how we're gonna go about our day.
One of the things I wanna emphasize too is, you know, when we became administrators, I hate to admit this, but most of social media didn't exist. And so the landscape is really different, and what kids are experiencing and sharing and seeing is much broader. And we sometimes get questions from parents, community members, and sometimes when students have maybe made poor choices, like, well, why is this a school issue? Or how come you're getting involved in that? And quite frankly, if it impacts our students, we are involved. Sometimes we ask ourselves that question, but it's a partnership, and we have to be involved, even if it happens outside of school. If it's impacting students who are enrolled here in our school district, then it impacts our community, and it provides an opportunity for us to intervene. So that question comes up a lot, that, well, this doesn't really have anything to do with school, but oftentimes school is the place where those things are revealed to us. And so we do act, and we partner as we need to with families, with community. And it doesn't always mean discipline. And I think that's a message I want kids to know. And I think they've started to realize that, but that parents need to know that too, because you heard from Laura when she talked about what Dan Radka shared in the NPR was, I didn't know if it was a big deal. I didn't want to get him in trouble. And that is, I think, a message from us is, we need to know to intervene and share. And then we've tried to build trust with kids and with families to look at how we can handle it in a supportive way. And I'm gonna have Chief talk in a minute about school resource officer after Mr. Melillo, but I think the SRO and the way that we've partnered has helped in some cases build some trust. And then I promise I will answer the anonymous reporting question.
Just to add to the thing, that frustrated, angry kid who's bitter and is a concern is someone who's hurting very, very deeply. And part of what we get better at identifying and helping, we can bring that kid around, and that's the ideal outcome in all of that. I think kids are so lost and so broken and so hurt that they're kind of out of functioning normally in with the rest of us in school and out. And to keep open the fact that that's a hurting kid and to try to bring that person in toward getting some help. And there's also that other piece to go. to work on.
Chief, I'm going to ask, we had a question. What is the role of the SRO in the schools?
Okay, well, good, this one I can answer. So the role of the SRO here in Clinton is, our SRO, he's housed here at Morgan, and he does spend the majority of his time here at the high school, but he is the district SRO. So his job is to interface with the faculty, with the students across the board, whether that be Joel, Elliot, Pearson, or here at Morgan. And a lot of it is a law enforcement role. Listen, if there's things that, if there's serious crimes that occur here, he's here, direct access, but that's a very small fraction of what he does. The main thing that he does is connect us to issues, and he's an avenue for people to come and let us know that there's problems and let us intervene. And whether that be get them to social services, get them in front of the school administration, our job here is not to punish. Our job is to make the environment safe. I think it's very important that we have the SRO in the school system so that kids know, if I have a problem, I'm gonna go to the guy wearing the blue. I'm gonna go to the guy that has the badge on him and say, listen, I have a problem, and know that he's going to help me. Not that he's gonna slam the cuffs on me, chuck me in the back of the car, and call my parents. That's not what we want. But they also know that we do have a responsibility. And I think that's clearly articulated to everybody, and everybody in the school system understands that we do have a responsibility to keep you safe. And if you tell us something that we need to investigate, we can't say, oh, well, you know, you told us that, and now we're not really gonna address it. We have to address it. And we do so with kid gloves. So, and I think the more that we do that, the more that builds trust. And again, that's a huge piece of why we have the SRO. It's a huge trust building piece for us. So we have that point person, not only for the kids, but for the faculty. They're here and they see the norm. They see what norm is. So when something is off, they can quickly pick up on that. And another thing that I want to point to is, even though we don't have a school resource officer stationed in each one of the schools, during the normal course of their patrols, my officers will get out and they'll go into each one of the schools at any given point during the day. So that does a couple of things for us. Now, if somebody is planning on an act of violence at the school, they don't know when a cop's going to show up. Second thing is that my officers do know what normal looks like. They'll walk through the school, they'll see what the normal ebb and flow looks like. So if they happen to walk in the school one day and something is off, that's very evident to them. They'll be able to say, hey, something's not right here, and we can quickly get to the source of a problem. So that's the role of the SRO is truly just an interface, more or less. That's his main role, to interface us with this community, to make sure that we're servicing the needs and that we have quicker reactionary times and gather better information to keep everybody safe.
So there are two related questions. One is, what is the safe reporting system at the middle school and high school, and can we describe? And I think we shared a couple of ways. We don't have an established phone line in particular for anonymous reporting at this point. And so we learned about the anonymous reporting system this summer, and also the programs, and we worked initially towards bringing the Start With Hello, the Save Clubs, and then the training of Say Something. And we have been speaking about at our Crisis Advisory Board meeting that two next steps. One is around the anonymous reporting system, and quite frankly, we learned, and I've been speaking with Superintendent Freeman in Guilford, that they were implementing. And so I've kind of watched and talked and explored their implementation process, and actually happened to be at a training with Dr. Freeman when they went live, and they went live in January. I thought they had been up and running. And so as we talked about it, I was experiencing his reaction the first weekend that they were live and how it was working. And then I did just speak to him a week ago about where they were at now and how it's going. And you know, he had a lot of positive responses. It wasn't easy. And I'm gonna let you guys talk a little too, but it wasn't easy. It took a long time to train, to partner with police and get everybody ready to roll it out properly. You know, we've talked about the idea that the social media concept or an app, which is much more in tune with the way that kids share information, is probably a great way to give kids that anonymous way. They don't have to email the principal. They don't have to reach out to the SRO. That group that we may be missing that would reach out if they could do it in a way that was more in their language is something that is important to me, and this looks like a platform that could work for us. So Guilford is in the in a much better phase now that they've implemented for a couple of months, and Dr. Freeman shared a story similar to yours, Marykay, and it was actually two students who were playing Fortnite. He said it's the first good thing that came out of kids playing Fortnite. But they were actually playing with someone, and that someone was making some statements and sharing some things that were just uncomfortable. And the kids had gone through the training and had the anonymous reporting system, and they were able to go in and tell their principal that, you know, there's this person online, and there was enough information about the person online that it wasn't a student at the middle school. What they found was that it was a student out in Michigan. And they were able to reach out. The police department in Guilford reached out. They located the child at a particular school, and they were able to intervene with a child who did need support and needed intervention. And again, I had chills when you shared your story, as I do now as I'm saying that. So it is something that I see as kind of a next step to explore for us, and to give kids that opportunity. All it takes is one, but those are really powerful stories to make a difference. And I do think we have a need to give kids an opportunity to talk to us, not just you have to go to an adult and tell them. Not every child's going to do that, and this would be a way to allow us. So I don't know if you can talk a little bit about the implementation phase. I was surprised to hear it took them almost a year to get up and running with training. So if you don't mind, I'd love for you to share a little bit.
It doesn't have to take a year. Let's just say that. It's a logistics puzzle at the start, plain and simple, because you need to have who's going to be the administrator, who's going to be the crisis team within the school, which is roughly 3 to 5 people per building of a school campus. How are you going to involve law enforcement? And then once the people are identified, it can be a fairly rapid process. Because all the collateral already exists, the crisis center already exists, it's then training. So the admin training, I think, is like 1 to 2 hours. The school crisis team training is about 4 hours, I believe. Law enforcement is another few hours. And then we have a good amount of testing, because before, the second you train the students, you are live, plain and simple. They start submitting tips from the presentation. Yeah, so you need to, we do all the QA, tons and tons of testing, 24/7, 365, to just ensure that everything works properly, that the audit trails are working, that everything, we understand your protocols, because we do some customization between what's life safety in your community versus life safety elsewhere and non-life safety. Are you going to have the school team get tips 24/7 or between the hours of 6 a.m. and 6 p.m.? How can we ensure that you're informed so that you know what you're coming into the next day at school? And because a lot of these more serious tips, the life safety tips, are truly coming in the evenings, in the early morning hours. So it can move fast once people are identified, and then the second you train the kids, you're live. Once you go live, what we're seeing typically is a kind of flood of tips to start off with. And that's perfectly normal, because the kids finally have a tool to talk, in addition to talking to a trusted adult. Some of them have been holding things for a while. What we're finding in a lot of school systems is those first influx of tips, fortunately, are ones that the school teams are already aware of, which is great, because that means the system's working. Roughly around 3 to 5% of kids who are trained annually are going to report something. So if you think about the size of your school, the size of your district, you can kind of quantify how many tips you're going to be dealing with. Of those, up to 40% will be life safety, and 10 to 15% within those will be incredibly serious. And a lot of people also ask about hoax claims. What's that's coming through so far? And other states that have this have also proven out the same sort of model. It's like less than half of 1%. And it's the sort of tip of, you know, clowns have red hair. It's kids testing out the system. but it can move fast. It's all about the initial planning, and once that's in place, we can go rapidly.
So one of the other questions, there are actually two related questions that talk about our teachers and their role in all of this. Teachers see a lot. How does Clinton work to hear their teachers? And outside of the SAVE program, what role can or should teachers play in identifying at risk? And so we've talked, and I know you mentioned a lot about students in the two generations. And so I look at teachers, and we get lots and lots of information from our teachers. And I will say honestly that some teachers feel uncomfortable sometimes with all of the training and then taking on this burden, if you will, of wanting to make sure everybody's safe because they feel it so deeply. And every additional layer then, okay, how do I do it? How do I do it right? What do I do? And so we have been thoughtful about the training and the way that we try to support teachers. But just like kids, every teacher brings a different experience, a different skill set and capacity and comfort level. So for us, I think my approach has been using this monthly crisis advisory board that engages administrators from each teacher and setting a path forward of thoughtful training experiences and opportunities for staff to engage in ways that will empower them. And it is about empowerment, empowering our kids, our teachers. And I think one of the missing pieces is community and parents as well. One of the other programs is around the safety assessment and intervention. And there are some trainings that are happening in the state that, and we actually, I think, might be invited to, but would allow a group of school staff to really be trained in how to identify, assess, and respond to threats within the school. Research-based, it's one of the Sandy Hook Promise programs, and I think that's another good next step for us to identify those pockets of people that some of whom we know already are part of our crisis teams, but also thoughtfully how that can then influence within the building and empower staff to feel more confident in how they respond and when they see signs, the pathways to report. So it's ongoing work. It's not something we could do a training. We did the suicide training, which generated a lot of conversation and thinking about how we respond and teachers' roles in that. And so it's ongoing work. And I think as we use some of these programs and continue our path, all of those things continue to enhance and we refine, and we need to listen, and we need to have the opportunities to listen. I'm gonna add one other question, or it's a little bit of a statement, but the idea of getting engaged and, you know, how can we help support and sustain some of the concepts and programs of Sandy Hook Promise here in Clinton? How can we support Sandy Hook Promise? And you guys shared some of the ways to get involved. But I'll share this because someone wrote, you know, getting engaged was given as the best way for a community to get involved. And unfortunately, even here tonight, right, we wish we had three times the turnout for this kind of important conversation. And I think partly we all live really busy lives, and finding the time to commit and attend to these kind of events is difficult. But with that, you know, we've marketed it. There's some disappointment, I think, that drawing people in and engaging a community around these conversations is really important because the schools can't do it all, the police can't do it all, human services can't. And so there is that third piece of community, and the PTA, human services, Clinton Youth and Family programs underneath human services have tried to do that. And I think we all need to make that commitment that together we're going to keep this moving forward. I see Marie Panette in the audience tonight, a member of our Human Services Department, and she's done so much work with the schools and outside of the schools on mental health first aid training. And we had a tremendous number of Clinton residents and community members who have been trained in youth mental health. I'm gonna say it wrong. First aid, I said it right the first time, mental health first aid. And so I think it is that partnership of within our schools what we're doing, but how do we reach out and get our coaches and our church leaders and our parents to engage in these understanding the signs and getting some training and understanding ways to communicate, because the anonymous reporting system for our students will do